local government. Salesforce maintains a dedicated team to support sales and marketing for all its vendors, including Adobe and Defense Connect Online. Our information will be at the end of the presentation, so please don't hesitate to call or email us with any of your needs. This webinar is also being recorded, and a copy of the presentation will be emailed to you. At this time, I'd like to introduce our speaker for today, Brett Miller, Milsig Solutions Engineer. Brett, the floor is all yours.
Thanks, Sam, and welcome everyone to this in-depth training session on Milsig. Yesterday, we started with the why Milsig, and we'll do that again today, just for those who weren't here yesterday. And the big thing, the big driving force behind it mostly is that we recognize in our private lives, in our personal lives, we use the tools that that are available to us, you know, for free, mostly Facebook, YouTube, Twitter, Tumblr, LinkedIn, to connect with friends, to connect with family, to share information, to use a term to live out loud, right? To let others know what you're doing, and also to be able to keep up with others. And the need for that is no less prevalent in the world of work and our professional lives, and that's what Milsig provides. But unlike most of the corporate IT systems within the DoD, which are designed from the top down, and fielded from the top down, and implemented based on executing the processes and ideas that we already know and the things that we already know how to do, Milsig fits in that space where we may not know exactly what needs to be done. We just know that we have a mission to accomplish, and there are others out there that might be able to help us, whether we already know them or not. So with Milsig, what we have is a tool that allows anyone with a DoD CAC to get an account and to use the full range of the tools available within the product suite. And we've got the four main products: Notebook for general collaboration and connection, Notepad for sharing ideas and information that you find useful, NotWiki, kind of like Wikipedia, it's an encyclopedia, a way to share information, and then Notube to share and stream videos. So you can see the video on the slide, some of the things that you can do. The tool is user-centric, which means that it's up to each individual to use the product in the way that best meets their own needs. There are ways for organizations to apply this and leverage this. For the most part, what we encourage organizations to do is not so much direct the use of Milsig in a specific way, but to allow and encourage their workforce to use the products in the way that they find works best for them. Because everyone's job is different, everyone's approach to their job is different, and the tools within Milsig allow for each individual to develop a process that works for them in conjunction with others. But today we're going to focus exclusively on Notebook. And I think you'll see why as we go through. It's not to say that the other products don't have some value when we're looking at working as a part of a group. We'll get into that a little bit more tomorrow. But today we're going to focus just on Notebook. And yesterday when we spoke about, in the basic training session, we spoke about how individuals can use a Notebook to connect with others, to keep up with information, to follow people. And we focused pretty much on those personal connections and using the status update as a way to share information with others and as a way to see what others are doing. But the status update is not the only thing that you can post, and it's not the only way that you can share and connect with others. Across the top here, above the status update bar, you'll see a menu to create different items. You're ranging from a discussion, files, documents, a blog post, and all of the rest. So for example, a status update, when you post it, the people who follow you will see that and can respond to it, can connect. But the status update is very limited in, you know, its capabilities, what you can provide. So one of the things you may want to use instead is the blog post as an example. So every mobile user has a personal blog that they can set up and use to post the longer form thoughts about things that you think would be of value to the people who follow you. But again, like the status update, it goes out to the people who follow you. They will get the notifications, and then they can respond and they can connect. And it's a very valuable tool. But sometimes what you want to do is connect more directly with just a certain group of people. You know, you want to connect with two or three or maybe even one person that you want to share. And so that's where you can use something like the discussion. Or go back, and if you just simply click on the create discussion button there, what you'll get is a form to create your discussion. You create a title, you type in a little bit of text in the text field, and this is how you can start that discussion. And then as you scroll down the page, you will see some options on where you want to post this. And so if you select Notebook Home, which I don't have highlighted here, but if you were to select Notebook Home, then that would be kind of like that blog post. That would be something that you're posting that is available to everyone in your book and that the people who follow you will get notifications of. And sometimes that's what you want to do. You want to have that public discussion with the people who follow you. But sometimes you would rather have it a bit more private. Maybe you want to have with a couple of your teammates that you want to discuss something with before you open it up to a broader audience. And in that case, you would select specific people. And once you've selected specific people, you will get a box here if you want the ones to type the name. And if you type in the name, then as you type in the name, you will get a list of possible matches. So this one shows just my name. I just typed that in so you can see it as an example. If I had just typed in Brett, for instance, there would be a longer list of people whose name included Brett. So you can then pick the person that you wanted to include. And this is an example of one of the reasons that we so strongly encourage you to upload an avatar, a custom avatar, or a picture as an avatar, because if there were, for instance, several GBAT members, then you know, you'd be able to look at the picture, the avatar and the image to see would help you figure out who it is that you wanted to send it to. Well, sometimes, you know, when you want to have one of these discussions, it's with, you know, an ad hoc group of people. Oh, let's see, they're going to shoot Jason and tell them, you know, this discussion and let them see what they have to say about it. But sometimes you have a more consistent group of people that you want to share things with. For example, the example I use here is an organization I've worked with recently, the OpNav M4. Now, in this case, there's 13 people from my office that I work with and share some things with. So what I was able to do is create, as part of my connections who are following, this label called OpNav M4. And I'm not going to go into the details of how that works, but I do encourage you, if you want to use this, it's a great tool to go to menu, to your signing labels to connections procedure. And what this allows you to do is say, okay, these people in OpNav M4 that I interact with quite a bit, as an example, or I have another one for the Muslim team that I may interact with, I can create this label, and then as I follow someone from an organization, I add into this label, and then I can easily share content with that particular group of people that I am following. So once you've selected, in this case, the OpNav M4, then it will show up on there. When I save this discussion, there will be notifications that they've been added onto this discussion so that they can come in and look at it. And again, this is very valuable if what you want to do is connect with people who you know and who you were following. And you can use this with not just discussions, but with documents or uploaded files and some of the other things. Now, sometimes you don't know exactly who it is that you want to share something with. When you have a group of your friends and colleagues that you follow in depth of this level, and sometimes you want to connect with people more around a broader functional area, and you want to make it available to not necessarily just notebook as a whole in this general space, but you want to have it kind of sectioned off a little bit so it's a little bit easier to find. But if you use on Facebook, to use that as an example, there are groups on Facebook where you can connect in various different levels of privacy. But in notebook, we have a very similar thing. In fact, it's essentially the same thing. And you probably noticed, I think some of you may have looked at this and said, in a place, but what is a place? What do you mean in a place? Well, if you think back to the activity feed, the connection stream, you've probably seen, in addition to all of those status updates that are just people posting things, you've seen that someone has joined, in this case, transportability engineering, for instance, or this item was posted in this user's group. And those are a place within notebook called a group. But to see all of the groups that are available in notebook, and there are quite a few, if you go to the places link in the notebook header, that will take you to the overview of places. Now this one by default you will see communities, projects, and groups when you're going to look at it. I have filtered this to just show the groups. We'll talk more about communities tomorrow, so if you have questions about those, we'll be addressing those in detail tomorrow. So here you see that there are a wide range of groups. And there's everything from this smart book, BOPN 611-21, from the Army Human Resources Command, which is a way to share information and updates about this specific publication, BOPN 611-21. And then you've got several other different groups with various different meanings. You can get a good idea from the title of what community or people they serve and who is involved. You also see that the groups have different levels of privacy or openness. Keep in mind, we discussed yesterday at that link that notebook operates on the suite, in general operates on the philosophy of open by default and restricted by exception. So when you create a group in notebook, you can make it more restrictive in terms of access, but by default it is open. And this is a way you can see here, you've got everything from open to members only to private. There's also a listed group, and we'll talk about those in a little bit more detail. So this place gives you an idea of the groups that are out there, how many members there are, how many people are following. So you can see that some of these are much more active. I mean, the smart book is intended to be an online-wide thing, so obviously you would expect to see a lot of followers. A private group around a very specific function with only 8 followers, very well may be that is just the intended audience. And that's the beauty of notebook groups, is that they can support as small a group of people or as large a group of people as you may need. An example of the group I'm going to show you the most with group, which many of you may have seen. A group is really just a container for content. And in general, there are 2 main views of a group when you go into it. What you see here is the activity page, which is the default based when you create a group. And it's very similar to the main notebook activity stream, or the activity feed or your connection stream. But it's very much by design, because the focus of most groups, of most collaboration, is really about the conversation, about the activity. So here you can see that I posted the slides from yesterday. So that shows up in the recent activity. You can see that there are comments. And just like in the main activity feed, you can show more comments, show fewer comments. You can expand individual comments. You can reply, you can like. Now, as a group owner, when you configure your group and you set up this activity page, you have control over what is displayed here on the right-hand side in what we call tiles. And you also notice that just like the main activity feed in Notebook, you've got this create menu. Now, unlike the main activity feed menu, which defaults to the main, it defaults to open, basically. When you create your content with one of these links, say a discussion, it will automatically be created, that selection will be created to have it show inside of this group. Now, the other view that you have within your groups is this overview page. Now, the overview page has, there are many, many widgets that you can put on here to control the content that you see. Obviously, you can show an activity type display. In this case, this is actually watching tags. It's anything tagged with multiple files from across Notebook that displays it here. So you can pull content from outside to show your group members. And you've got other widgets such as ask a question, featured content. And this is using just a static content widget to display an image that has a link to another site. Then as you scroll down the page, you can see that you can put different things. You can show polls, you can have links to other groups, and you know, pull things in from all around to make the experience for your users that much better. I'm not going to go into a lot of detail in this today. We have resources on MemoView and within the Notebook users community that goes through these in depth. I just wanted to show you this layout editor here that shows how many widgets are out there. You've got all these different categories, you've got different options. So when you put this page together, there are a lot of possibilities, I guess, is the best way to put it. Now, to create a group, just like you can create any content, if you click on that little panel up there on the top, which is the Create menu, you'll see an option to create any of these content types that you can then place into an existing group. Or if a group does not exist that you think would be the best for you, then you can create your own group. But I would encourage you, before you go and create a new group, that you go to the Places viewer and do a search and see if there is already a group that meets your need. And as you go through, you'll see that there's everything from an Apple users group, Microsoft Office, there's one called Travelers Unite, which is for people who travel a lot to find the best places to stay and that sort of thing. There are a lot of groups that people have created to try to connect with people that you might be able to use. Now, obviously, if you're setting up something new for your specific organization or your unit, then it doesn't exist, then you'll want to go ahead and create it. So to create it, again, we click on the little create icon, click on group to create your group, and then what you'll see is the create group menu. And you've got the basic information to give your place a name. You want the group to have a name that's descriptive, that kind of gets across what it is that you want to do. Type in your description, and then you'll see that as you type in your group name, the URL for your group is populated. You can change this when you create the group, and this is really important. You can change it when you create the group, but you can't change it once the group has been created. So that's very important to remember that, think a little bit more in term, because you can't change that URL once it's been created. And then we have the examples of tags in here, but when you create your group, you should tag it with information that would make it so that it would show up in a search. So for instance, if it was knowledge management, KM, if it's an army related group, if it's Netflix related group, if it's technology, but whatever tags would best support people finding it and connecting with it. Now under the type of a group really refers to the level of permissions that are available inside of that group. And as you can see, it goes from open to unlisted. And an open group is what we encourage as much as possible, because even though you are containing all of this content inside of the group, for the most part, what you're working on may be of interest to someone that you don't even know yet. You may not know that there's someone else who has an interest in the group that you have. And for some people, that's why we create a group, right? To find other people. That's why you tag it, so that other people can find you and you can connect with them and share and collaborate. Now, not everything is that way. It's not an individual community of interest, say, like the Apple users group, which is a bunch of people who use Apple products and government and want to talk with others who do. Or sometimes you may have a group that supports a specific organizational or unit mission or effort. And so you may want to have it private, just to keep that conversation contained. Even then, I would suggest that you look at it and think of it in the context of open by default and restricted by access. Because throughout my career with the DoD and using the information systems, for the most part, systems are restricted by default and open by access. When one of the first things that is discussed when we're creating a new system or something, say, on SharePoint or any other type of system, is, well, who should have access to it? How do we control who sees this? And so it starts off as, who should see this, and we don't want anyone else to see it. And on this one, when you're creating your group, when you're posting any content, actually, look at it from the perspective of, not, we need to restrict this to this group of people, how do we keep everyone else out, but here is some information that we want to share. Is there a reason for us not to let everyone see it? And it's kind of that difference between need to know, which is how most systems work, and that's how they work, and rightfully so, identifying the need to know and giving access just to them, and the responsibility to share, which is more in the model that MoSuite is built on. Again, MoSuite is approved for up to FOMO, unclassified, obviously. And the audience is restricted to DoD CAC holders. So when you post content and when you create your group, you look at it from the standpoint of, we should make this available to as many people as possible. And one thing that may come up is, and we hear this a lot, is, well, they don't need to see that, or they don't want to see that. There's no reason for them to see that. And the thing to keep in mind, again, from the perspective of this user-centric system like MoSuite, is the beauty of it, at least from my perspective, is you don't have to worry about what someone else wants. Right? If you post some content, if you create a group that someone else doesn't care about, they're not going to visit it. And that's something that you just have come to terms with, that you have a much harder time getting people to visit your content than you do keeping them out in general. So just keep that in mind when you're creating the group and you're creating the content. The unlisted group is one that will make it so that your group is not seen in searches, when it won't show up. Once you invite someone to see it, they know the notes there. And what we do kind of recommend is when you first create your group, start it out as unlisted so that you can get it configured the way you want. And then go as open as you can. Now the other option when you set this up is to have either an activity page, an overview page, or both. And that's really entirely up to you on how much work you want to do in pulling things together. If all you want to do is enable a conversation, all you really need is the activity page. If you have bigger goals in terms of putting information out and controlling, you know, kind of the presentation and what your members see and being more of a facilitator, then you may also want to have the overview page. Now, I'm not going to go through every step here in creating the group. I'm kind of going through some of the philosophy behind it. But one more view, again, there is a procedure for creating a group. It will take you through these different steps. And then in Notebook or the Notebook Users Group, there is a place to ask questions. The group owner and community administrator forum, there is full of people who have done this or are working on it and have some good suggestions and ideas that will help you as you put your group together. All right, so I'm going back here to the place view just to show you what some of them are. And it's worth looking here at the menu on the side with these filters. By default, when we go to those groups or those places page, you will see all. That's just what it's set as. Now, as you follow more or as you learn more, you can click on each of those. I don't have a screenshot of each of those to show you, but they will filter based on each of those particular attributes, and you can select any one of those as your actual default places filter by clicking on the little push button that's going to show up. I do have a couple of examples to show you of some groups that were created and the different philosophies and aspects behind them. So this Microsoft Office group was set up by someone who was interested in doing Microsoft Office work, you know, development, doing macros, doing that type of thing, and it has quite a few members. And I've actually referenced people here quite often, and, you know, dealing especially with Excel, and trying to do some fancy stuff with Excel. But this is what we would call a community of interest. Someone had a thought, hey, I'd like to connect with other people and share ideas about this. Other people find it, come in and contribute it. The focus is on the content and on the activity. Even though there may be a couple of other little things here and there, it's really all about just connecting people and allowing them to share their ideas. Now, another way that groups can be used is by an organization. For instance, I've been working with OutMap on Thor recently. And one of the groups that they have is this one, the Navy Additive Manufacturers. So they have an interest within the fleet readiness realm in additive manufacturing, 3D printing, and communicating with the fleet and with others involved in additive manufacturing to share ideas again and see how things are going. So this is an example of an organizationally sponsored group that is meant to reach out to the community of users, not necessarily to execute a specific organizational function, you know, or process, but as a way to help the members of the organization better do their job by connecting with others and the sharing of information. Another example from the Navy is Navy Brightwork from the Navy Warfare Development Command. And what they've done is used the very specific content item, the idea, and built around it this idea generation space. And so it's a way for them to get feedback from the field or from the fleet to get ideas on anything, you know, ranging from the energy to other things. I'm an Army guy, so I don't remember all of the things that they have on here, but it allows for them to submit their ideas. It allows for others to comment on the ideas, that has a voting feature so that people can vote yes or no, just to give an idea of what, you know, what people in that area think of a specific idea. And it's just a great way to get that conversation flowing and to get it going. And again, this is an example of an organization using the tool not to tell their unit or their organization information, not to publish just static information, but as a way to engage in that communication and that collaboration and to get the feedback. And again, it builds on that user-centric nature of the MuleSuite tools. I'm not going to show you these groups specifically, their layouts, or let me go back to Maven Brightwork real quick. Because the other thing that this shows you, and what Maven Brightwork has done, and what, you know, quite a few others have done, is you have some control of how you can have your overview page displayed. So they put a little bit of branding into this, a little bit of the background colors, and they use the nice background image here so that you can customize the appearance a little bit and make it a little bit more appealing, I guess. You know, even though the focus is on the collaboration, you know, sometimes having a little bit of branding goes a long way. Now, another way that organizations are using it is an example here from the Army's Warrant Officer Candidate School. So as one officer candidates are selected to attend school, they receive a welcome letter. And part of that welcome letter is, you as a group need to get together and come up and do these things before you show up at class. So these groups are created and operated by the members of the class. They will share, communicate with each other. They come up with things that, you know, they complete those actions before they get there. So this is an example of an organization using it in support of, you know, a training environment or an education environment. And you have also people using notebook groups and communities as a way to support actual classroom activities. And the Warrant Officer Candidate School does that as well. These groups, for the most part, since they're open, they're not sharing any curriculum or anything. It's really all about that connecting and getting to know each other before you show up at the class. And again, this is something that the organization, they direct them, I guess, to use Notebook to do this. But it's really up to the individuals to do the connecting and to make it work for them. Now, another excellent example of this is what the Army Georgia Africa General Corps has done, incorporating Notebook as part of their overall knowledge management strategy. Now, as part of their overall knowledge management strategy, they have, you know, a document library. I don't know what tool they use or anything, but it's not Notebook. They have a document management system that they use. They have other, you know, the tasking management systems and all of those formal business processes that they use, systems designed for those business processes. But what they've done is created these communities of practice using groups on Notebook and encouraged, or they allow and they encourage their members of the JAG Corps to join the appropriate group, whichever practice area they may be in, as a way to connect and collaborate with others in that practice area from around the world. And you can see that some of these are very active and very large. So you've got the leadership management and training group with over 1,200 members. The administrative law group has almost 2,000 members from the JAG Corps. And this is, it's important to recognize that this has been, this is voluntary, really, on the part of the JAG. They were told, here is, you know, these groups, and they had some people in charge of setting them up and doing some marketing. But they didn't say, here's the Notebook group for administrative law. If you're an administrative law person, you need to go in this group and you have to post something every day or every other day. They said, here's this group for you to connect and to share with each other. We encourage you to do that and to use it. And get the value from it. Instead of using email and trying to send it to, 2,000 people, you can post it here in this group and then connect and get answers from people that you may not have otherwise been able to connect to using email or those strict business process models that those other systems have. And I like to go back to that as kind of a driving force behind groups and how they relate to organizations. Organizations and units can use mobile groups to support their mission. And we'll talk about how they can use communities tomorrow in a more direct fashion. But in general, the best thing that organizations can do to get the best value out of mobile is to just let the workforce know that when they're allowed to use mobile, because some people are more concerned that they shouldn't be using it, and then to encourage the use of it, and then reap the benefits of them using the platform to communicate and to collaborate. Now, yesterday when we were talking about individuals and connecting with people, we talked about the value of those connections. And sometimes you don't know who you need to connect to because you haven't met the person yet or you haven't come across them. And so what you can do and what we encourage is if you find a group that you're interested in or that you're participating in, follow that group so that you can get these updates when someone posts in that group. And what you will find over time as you use this is that you will meet new people that are great people for you to know in your functionality and your specialty that you would never have come across in any way except you happen to be in the same mobile group talking about a topic of common interest. So that's pretty much the basics of the groups. Like I said, I didn't go through the details of how you set one up. Hopefully I kind of got across the value of them and the fact that anyone can create one is both a good thing and a bad thing, I think, because it's a good thing because it empowers everyone to use the tool in the best way that meets their need. Of course, it's a bad thing, it's like, in quotes, a bad thing, just because it is possible to maybe overdo it a little bit, especially if you're trying to keep things private, and make a whole bunch of stovepipes. One of the big reasons that MuleSuite was successful against Gavi was that it kind of breaks down the stovepipes, that open by default kind of breaks down the stovepipes, because as an enterprise now everyone can see what's going on. So it's not that everyone can see what everyone else is doing, it's that everyone has situational awareness and can see what's going on. And the danger with groups, especially if they're creating as private groups, is you essentially end up creating stovepipes inside of MuleSuite, which is what we would like to hopefully avoid. Now I'm going to take a quick look at the questions. My teammate Jason Bach has been answering most of these questions, and he has sent a few of them to me, so I'm going to take a look and see what those are and answer the ones that I can. question from Dan Vietnam Cyber. I'll read the question. How can a commander use this platform to create specific groups to communicate with his or her subordinate commanders and staffs? We'll talk about that in more detail tomorrow when we talk about communities and some groups, but the topic tomorrow is how you use it as a more directed system. The one thing I will say today about that, though, Dan, is that it's a, because MuleSuite is a user-centric system, it's not something where it's not easy to have a system where you can make someone do something, right? So you can't technically make someone follow someone else, right? So you have a commander, you can tell everyone, hey, you need to follow the commander, know, he's going to look on the list and see that you had it. So it kind of comes down to a governance thing. And if you can make it tomorrow, we'll talk about that in more detail. It's kind of the subject of tomorrow. And the next question is, are there materials available that I can use to get the word out about Newsweek? There are, in fact, we have, well, I don't have a screenshot of it specifically. If you go to Millsuite, we have a couple of resources, and I talked about a little bit of it yesterday, but one of the things that we have on MillWiki is this page called Using Millsuite. And what we've done is, for each of these applications, going through and created some basic information about how you can use them, some service-specific things based on some maybe specific organizational and unit-based ideas. And then we also have specific playbooks that talk about how you can use the tools to accomplish specific things. Also on MillWiki, and I don't have a page to show here, but if you go just to MillWiki to the home page, you will see a link to the MillSuite Media Kit. And you do have PDF posters that you can put and distribute, the graphics, things that you can use in your own presentations. Obviously, we're using venues like this bootcamp to get the word out about MillSuite, and also starting to see it show up on different organizational portals. So for instance, the Air Force portal has a link to MillSuite on it now. There's a link to MillSuite from the AKA homepage. So it's starting to get out quite a bit.
Hey, Brett, the MillSuite Media link is in the global header under More.
Oh, excellent.
So you've got Mill University in there as well as the MillSuite Media page.
Okay. Thank you, Jason, for letting me know about that. I think I may have missed that in the Mill link. And speaking of Mill University, the other thing that I really encourage you to look at is the Mill U procedure pages for the various products. So you can go to millsuite.mill/learn/millsuite, and Mill have links to each of the four products, and then you can get in there and get much more detail about those. Now, one thing, I haven't looked at all of the questions that were through there, just the ones that Jason threw my way. I think one of the big questions, and I'm sure I'll see it, you know, if I go back and look at those questions, is, you know, can we upload the files, and, you know, how many can we upload, how much can we upload? And, you know, there are limits in what's described in the MillWiki users community and frequently asked questions. It's fairly small. Individual file sizes are 30 megabytes, and then we've got limitations in the groups, for instance, of 1 gigabyte total, which is quite a bit, but it goes by fast for some people. And the one thing I would say with regard to that is that the MillBook is not a document management tool, right? It's not a file repository. Although you can upload files, and you can share them that way. That's not really how it was designed and intended to be used. So if you have serious document management, file management needs, MillBook is probably not the best option for you, even inside of a group, although you can use it that way. Today we went through the, you know, sharing with, you know, groups of people, other people, but as a user-centric system, again, MillSuite is built around each individual doing their own thing, controlling what they see and what they post, using, like I mentioned, labels with the connections that we have is one way to target, you know, what you share with other people, and groups is a way to target what you share with other people, but also a way to provide a place where people of like mind can come together to talk about a specific topic. And again, it all gets back to that connecting people helping people implement their own personal knowledge management tools and their own personal learning environment, so that they can connect with who and what best supports what they need to do, and also provide value to others simply by working out loud, simply by participating in these forums and providing information, whether they know that it's going to be of direct value to someone else or not.
Hey, Brent, I don't know if this is too off topic, but I had a few questions in there about tagging. So I wonder maybe if you could take a second to talk about categories and tags on each one of the sites, if you've got some time left, and how it's a little different, but how they should be used.
Sure. I don't think I have a screenshot that I can show.
Yeah, sorry.
No, that's fine. I think there's quite a bit of discussion about this in the MoBook Frequently Asked Questions inside the MoBook users community. But basically, categories within a group, you have one level of categories, right? So that you can create. So, for instance, in the most weak group, you know, we may have a category, and I don't know if this is true or not, but we may have a category for the book, one for the wire, one for the wiki, so that when we post something that applies to say the book, we will put it in that category. And then there are certain filtering abilities you have in terms of the views, so that you can go in and look at, say, just the more book-related content. Categories are specific to a group, they're internal to a group, and they have no use or value outside of that group. It's purely for, maneuvering, navigating around inside of the group. Tags, on the other hand, are something that you would put on something that you post to let others know what it's about. So in a group, only the group owners and administrator for the group can create categories. But anyone who posts content inside the group can tag that content with what they think is appropriate. So if I post something that's about your book, and it's about permissions, and it's about categories, for instance, so I would put it in the category, your book, but then I would tag it, with categories and tags and, you know, knowledge management, say. By tagging it, inside the group, you can use it to help with your navigation, especially if you use a specific widget. But by tagging it, it makes that content available through a system-wide search of MoBook or even a most weak search. So if I tag something, knowledge management, in the most weak group, and someone else has, say, the watch tag widget in their group about knowledge management, right? They have a watch tag widget that shows everything tagged knowledge management across mobile. That's a way for someone outside of your group, assuming the group is open, someone outside of your group to become aware of that content, whether it's through a search or through that widget, and then possibly finding it not just to that particular piece of content, but to the group as a whole. Does that make sense? Something to that, you think, kind of cover it? Yep, thanks.
Okay.
And again, that's something that has come up quite a bit inside that MoBook users community. If you're interested at all in starting up a group, we encourage you please check out the MoBook users community, and especially the group owner and community admin forum, which is a sub-community to that MoBook users group, or users community. We talk there about the specifics of layout and design, governance, how you should set it up, how you can use it, and also some of the more technical aspects of the administration. And let's see if I got, I think that answers the bulk of the questions. I will need to go through the list and make sure that we haven't missed anything to see what we've got. Oh, there's one. One last one here, can more than one person in a group? That is a good question. I'm glad it came up, because in fact we strongly encourage you to assign multiple people to own a group, especially if it's a community of interest, such as, you know, say the Anthem Users Group as an example. If you create that because you're interested in it and you're active and then you move in or you move the government, and you don't really have access, but no one else knows has the ability to take over. So you can assign additional owners for a group, and we strongly encourage you to do that just for that continuity and for that purpose. So with that, I'll cut it off for today, and as a teaser for tomorrow, we'll talk a little bit about groups tomorrow too, but we'll focus probably more on communities. Then we'll also address the other products and how an organization or a commander can use Mostly as a way to reach out to the people that work for them, to their organizations, to their units, specifically in the execution of the organization or the unit's mission, as opposed to today when we're talking more generally about individuals connecting with others. So thank you for taking the time today. Thank you very much for all of your questions. The more tools, again, make sure we've got them all covered. And I look forward to talking to you all again tomorrow. Thank you very much. Sam, back to you.
Thanks, Brett. At this time, please take a moment to answer the polling questions displayed on your screen.